भ्यो नमः श्री गणेशाय नमः। यू हैव टू डू 14th वर्स, यू मे से इट। वृथा क्रिया वृथा लापान, वृथा वादान मनोरथान, त्यक्त्वैकं ब्रह्म विज्ञेयम् इति वेदांत डिंडिमः। वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग वर्स। त्यक्त्वा, हैविंग रिलिंक्विश्ड, सो वन हैज टू रिलिंक्विश क्वाइट अ फ्यू थिंग्स इन वेद इन फॉर टू गेन द नॉलेज ऑफ द सेल्फ। You need not accomplish anything. In fact, you have to relinquish quite a few things. Because self is ever accomplished. So, you need not accomplish anything. It's a very important thing. That's why all upadesha is in the form of negation. Neti neti tyadeshaha. Brahadaranyaka Upanishad. Adeshaha upadeshaha. All teaching is in the form of negation. In fact, sometimes I hesitate to say, because people may think that he is a crazy guy. But then, if you allow me a chance, I will say. So now I am saying. All negative understanding is the only right understanding. That is how it is. You think about it. So, what one has to do is, he need not acquire anything. The sadhana chatushtaya, etc., if you look at it, it is all negation only. You just analyze the sadhana chatushtaya. You hear of it quite often, that you have to equip yourself with these qualities. What are the qualities? Viveka, discrimination between the real and unreal. Because there is a confusion between the two. Why should we discriminate? Because we have to reject the unreal. Vairagya, rejecting the unreal. Vairagya is negative, non-attachment. There is no positive in vairagya. Vairagya is not holding on to something. Vairagya is about stopping to hold on to something. Then the shamadhi sampata, six qualities. Six qualities, they are all negative. To say briefly, Shama is the shanti, cessation. Shanti means cessation. Like Agni Shantaha, the fire is extinguished. That is the meaning of shanti. So cessation of the agitation of the mind which is committed to the opposites, Sukha Dukha. That is called Shama. Shama is the cessation of the agitation at the level of the mind which is agitated because of the opposites. So we develop sameness, as I told today morning. Thereby the mind stops getting agitated in the face of opposites. That is called Shama. Then Dama is the cessation of the agitation again. Ashanti Uparama, the cessation or putting a full stop to the agitation at the level of sense organs. That is Dhamma. Then Uparati, there is an agitation caused by activity, meaningless activity. That is Kriya, Vrtha Kriya. Uparati, I will tell what is the meaningless activity, but as you engage yourself in more and more activity, karma, we are not saying you should be lazy. We are talking of a will-based activity, the personal will-based activity, self-centered activity. That is the activity that we are talking about. So that kind of activity has to be reduced. That is Uparati, because the more active you are, the more agitated you become. Like the computer engineers and all these people who work for 12 to 14 years in the prime of the youth, I tell you, it looks as if it is all modernity and wonderful thing, that I see this in India all the time. This young man and young girls at the age of 20 to 23, they are in the prime of the youth. They are highly qualified and very highly motivated. They come out from the institutes and then they are grabbed by these multinational companies. And there is so much of outsourcing in India. All these big, big names you find in India. GE. Once I was going for some satsang, I saw a huge building, GE. Are, am I in Cincinnati or am I in Hyderabad? So it is like that. So all the multinational companies, they come there, establish their headquarters, their branches. And then we have Indian companies which serve the multinational companies like Tata, Infosys, etc. They grab these young people and they work hard, very committed and motivated people. Work 14 hours a day. And by the time they reach the age 35, they are wrecks. They have all kinds of problems and they will be now going to the corporate hospitals to check BP, to check heart, stomach, all kinds of things. They are the patients. If you go to a corporate hospital by mistake, you find them there. Not all, some of them. So, getting huge salaries, etc., it is not an achievement all the time. There is a negative side to it. In fact, all worldly accomplishment, please think about it, all worldly accomplishment has a very heavy downside to it. Anyway, we are not saying that you should not accomplish in the world and all that. We always say you should commit yourself to the duty. But the point here is, so what I was talking about is uparati, shamadama uparati. Uparati means a cessation of unnecessary activities which cause agitation. That kind of unnecessary activities must be stopped. You have to find out which is causing the agitation to the mind, which is robbing the peace of the mind. You have to locate it and address it. It is like finding the leaks and plugging those leaks. If water is leaking, you find out where it is leaking and plug those leaks. Like that, the mental energies are getting drained. Find the points where it is leaking and plug them. That is the shatsampatti. So the third is uparati. Then titiksha. So as the life presents the opposites, we get disturbed. And so we develop endurance so that we maintain that equanimity. So titiksha is a cessation of agitation caused by the opposites. So dvandva vikshepa shanti. Vikshepa is the agitation. These are the Sanskrit words. So that is the fourth. Then shraddha. The ego itself is a cause of agitation. Abhimana vikshepa. It is called abhimana vikshepa. Vikshepa is the agitation caused by the ego. So like hurt, guilt, etc., all kinds of things. So the ego-based agitation, agitation caused by the ego, that has to go away. Then finally, samadhana. The mind is hyperactive for no particular reason. So by nature it is hyperactive. Mind is like that, you know. And so that kind of hyperactivity of the mind has to be addressed. And the cessation of that hyperactivity is called samadhana. So these are the six qualities. Do you find anything positive in them? No, there is nothing positive in them. It is all negative. Then negative means negative to what? Not absolutely. Negative negation of the unreal worldly things. That is the negation. So one need not be sentimental about it. It is all negative. All right understanding is negative understanding. And ultimately, mumuksha, the desire for moksha. It is not a desire. The desire for moksha is a peculiar desire that puts an end to all the desires. That is the desire. I seek moksha means you do not seeking anything in particular. You are only rejecting quite a few things. So, I seek moksha means I do not seek anything related to the world. That is the meaning of it. Because moksha is one's own swarupa. One is really never bound. Anyway, so the point is the negation is the upadesha here. That's why you can see the negation by Shankara there, tyaktva, rejecting, relinquishing. What? Kriyaha. What kind of actions or activities? Vrutha kriyaha. Wasteful activities. You see, what is the goal of a karma? Activity is there in our life. What is the goal of karma? Activity. So, the goal is bhoga, pleasure seeking. So, in the philosophy, in the texts of ancient Indian philosophy, such a person who says that the goal of activity is bhoga is called charvaka. That is the name given to him. Charvaka, you know? Charvaka means a nastika vada it is. Agnostic or even atheistic philosophy. So they said the purpose of life is not heaven, etc. There is no moksha, etc. There is no atma. Only body is there. And therefore, the purpose of living is enjoyment of sense pleasures. This is what they told. It is called charvaka, charvaka siddhanta. Is it called hedonism or some such thing? I think so. You please check. So the purpose of life is bhoga. So very interestingly, this in modern times, we seem to live on those lines. Though we may not say we are charvaka disciples, but we live in a structure of sensate values. So much so, we may not be the direct disciples of charvaka, we are not atheists, but still we are bhoga people. We are committed to bhogas. We live in bhogas. This is our bane, I tell you. Therefore, vairagya becomes very difficult. While living in the bhogas, vairagya has no relevance, you know. That's why people stop talking about vairagya. Because if you start talking about it, it will be very inconvenient. Conveniently keep it aside. And then, sometimes somebody teaches about vairagya. So they are disturbed by that. Why so much vairagya he is teaching? Like that. Somebody asked me, why do you emphasize so much on vairagya? I told him, what am I teaching here? I am teaching Vedanta or I am addressing a group of business entrepreneurs? So, I am not addressing, this is not an MBA class where you try to use the Vedanta for the furthering the business. That they do it. So, the principles of Gita to improve business like that, from a seminar. So, it is not like that. So here we teach vairagya. Vairagya is the bread and butter for the Vedantins. Therefore, karma aimed at bhoga, it corrupts the person. Then, karma aimed at pleasing Ishvara, that is the goal. Ishvara preachartham, I do karma, I do meditation, and then surrender it to Ishvara. Then why should you surrender to Ishvara? Ishvara Preeti. You surrender it to Ishvara. Ishvara will be pleased with me as a devotee. He will be pleased with me. So what happens if Ishvara is pleased with me? Nothing need happen. That itself is the goal. Ishvara Preeti is the goal. Pleasing Ishvara is the goal. This is called Nishkama Bhakti Yoga. So, Devotee, we do have it in us as part of Vedantic sadhana. We do have it in us. We pray to the Lord, not for anything in particular. So there is prayer, and the prayer is a goal in itself. Therefore, that is called Nishkama Bhakti, and so karma performed for that purpose. That is wonderful. Then, there is another way of looking at it. Karma is performed for the purification of the heart. Yoginah karma kurvanti sangam tyaktvatma shuddhaye in Gita. So yoginaha means the seekers, the strivers, the sadhakas, they are called yogis. they perform actions, karma kurvanti. For what and how? How? Sangam tyaktva. Sangha is attachment. Attachment for what? Attachment for the results. So, don't worry about why should we act without result and all that. It is not like that. It is not such a simplistic thing. So, suppose a teacher is there. You employ a teacher for your ward, son or daughter, to teach some music. You pay some money, honorarium or stipend to the teacher on a monthly basis. He comes and sits for teaching the class. Then, just before taking the class, suppose he says to himself, by teaching these kids, I will get this much money, and then starts teaching. How do you feel about it if he does that? Suppose you go to a doctor, and then the doctor feels, okay, by giving medicine to this guy, I will get 100 rupees consultation fee. Suppose he feels that way, he calculates that way, and then treats you. How do you feel? Don't you feel lousy about it? It is like that. Ultimately, he takes fees and the teacher takes money. All that is there. But the focus should not be on the outcome, on the reward. We should not degenerate ourselves to such a level that we are all the time focused on the reward only. That is the extreme situation which I described. So, we always describe the extreme so that the point is made. Anyway, so results will be there. It's not that we do some meaningless work. Results will be there. But our focus should not be on the results. Result is in the future. Karma is in the present. Karma action is in the present. Result is in the future. Now where would you focus? Would you focus on the future or would you focus on the present? People who focus on the future, they will spoil the karma and their future is also spoiled. While walking there, will you focus on the goal or will you focus on the step that you have to take in this moment? That is what it means. Anyway, so I tell you, I met a Mahatma. We were talking about karma. Then he told me, Swamiji, it is difficult to perform karmas. Because performing a karma, it involves effort, skill, commitment, so many things are there. It is not easy. Performing karma, it is difficult. But then he says, he continues, stopping to do unnecessary karmas, refraining, that is the word, refraining from worldly actions is even more difficult. Therefore, that difficult thing we have to accomplish. Performing activity is difficult, but refraining from all unnecessary activity in life is even more difficult. And that even more difficult thing is what is pointed out by Shankara. Vrutha kriyah tyaktva. All unnecessary activities you just drop. Don't ask, then what shall I do? Don't ask that question. That is not the right question to ask. What shall I do is not the right question. The right question is, am I the doer? That is the right question. Am I the doer? Am I the enjoyer? That question you have to put in Vedanta. So, vrutha kriyah. So, sangam tyaktva atmasuddhaye yoginah karma kurvanti. I was explaining that. So, the yogis, the strivers, perform actions by relinquishing the attachment, sangam tyaktva. Then what for are they performing? It is meaningless? No, it is not meaningless. It is not that simplistic. They perform actions without any attachment for the sake of purifying the heart. Atma shuddhaye. Suppose I perform meditation. You see, people perform dhyanam for the samsara. Samsar ke liye yog karte hai. Like that Swami Akhandanandaji Maharaj used to say. Samsar ke liye yog karte hai. they perform yoga, they practice yoga for furthering samsara. So here is a gentleman. He has got a heart attack. God bless him, he was okay, some surgery, etc. Then the doctor told him, you should not get agitated. If you get agitated, you will get a heart attack. So if you don't get agitated, you will live longer. And so you need not take further medicines. You need not go to the hospital again, which is a nice goal in life. So he came to me, Swamiji, I want to learn meditation. You teach me. And I will give you whatever you want. I want to learn meditation. So that this is the... I asked, what is the purpose of meditation? So this is the purpose. I told him, you see, you don't do meditation for the sake of samsara. Don't put that kind of a silly goal that I have to live longer. So I have to attend... our kids, the samsaric, you know, just I give an example, I don't address any particular person, samsaric things aisa hote hai, that kind of an example. So I have to see the marriage of my granddaughter, that kind of wonderful. Granddaughter has to be married and the elderly people should attend, and but that should not be the goal of life, you know. Meditation is not meant for such a world. So to keep the body intact, that is not the purpose of meditation. Sansar ke liye yog karte hai. So, you know why? What happens? What is wrong in it? You may say, it won't work. It won't work. Because on one side you are working at cross purposes. So you practice meditation and then you want samsara. They are not compatible. Like water and oil, they won't mix. That's why it won't work. You get frustrated. So, you drop all activity which is aimed at samsara. Then the people ask, then what will happen? How to survive? This is another problem. Survival is a problem in Canada. I don't know whether it is in India or not, we will see. But is it a problem in Canada? Survival is not our issue. Our issue is something else. All imagined. How to survive? Everybody will survive. Everybody will survive. Only human being has this issue of survival. No other life form has the issue of survival. Only human being, who has already amassed a lot of wealth, is worried about survival. So, that is not an issue. Therefore, all activity which doesn't serve these two purposes, namely, Ishvara Prichartham, this karma is done. Do that. Atma Shuddhaye, Atma is Antahkarana, Antahkarana Shuddhi, purification of the heart, selfless activity for the purification of heart. I act in love. I love the members of the family. Therefore I act as a consequence of that love. Not for deriving some personal advantage. I act out of love. To the society, to the community, I act out of love. That is how the heart is purified. So the strivers perform such activities. Therefore, there are two steps involved here. One, there are a number of activities, a plethora of activities. Now, you choose. You are very choosy. Yoga karmasu kaushalam. That is karma kaushalam. It means quite a few things, I tell you. You have to look at the words and just take the meaning which is conveyed by them. Don't be carried away by all kinds of interpretations. Just look at the words. Yoga karmasu kaushalam. Kaushalam, it's if you look at the Sanskrit dictionary meaning, so very traditional dictionary, not even modern dictionary. So meaning is skill, dexterity. So when you perform an action, every movement must be purposeful. Every movement must be very purposeful. You should not move hands, etc., unnecessarily. Wasteful movements should not be there. It is like giving an injection to the patient. Will there be any wasteful movement there? No. The injection, the syringe is loaded, correctly loaded. And then one drop is expelled so that all air bubbles are expelled. And then correct position is located, inserted, and injected and then withdrawn. Perfect moment it must be. Suppose in a clumsy way you do, then the patient will say, oh, like that he will say. You do it perfectly, the patient, already it is over, injection is over already, you have finished it already. I asked a nurse like that, oh, is it over? Yes, Swamiji, my God, very skillful. That is yoga. Yoga karmasu kaushalam. Therefore, you choose the right actions, renounce, leave out all unnecessary movements. Movement is action, all unnecessary actions. Suppose this particular karma is there. Do I need to do it? No, I don't need to do it. Drop it. Don't do it. So dropping or refraining from all unnecessary activity is yoga. Yoga karmasu kaushalam. That is one aspect of yoga. Then now I now know if there are 10 activities which come before me in a routine way, I now know 8 of them are unnecessary. It is always like that. Then there are 2. Now I take up those 2 and perform them properly with a proper attitude. What is the attitude? The actions are not performed for the sake of bhoga. No. Na bhogaya. Then if bhoga is not there, there's the goal, then what is left? That is the thing. The real thing is now left as the goal. Once the unreal dross is removed, then the real thing comes forth. If it is devotion, bhakti, then the goal is Ishvara Preeti. Language is like that. Language of bhakti is like that. A bhakta says, Bhagavan ki preeti ke liye kar raha hun. Like that he says. I perform this activity to please the Lord, as an offering to the Lord. What will the Lord do with it? Whatever the Lord may do. From my side, offered. That's all. Once I say Shri Krishna Arpanamastu, I do not look back. Over. I am done with it. Surrender. That is bhakti. Then, another way of looking at it is Atma Shuddhaye. A selfless act. An act from which I do not try to derive any personal advantage. Can you imagine what kind of an action it is? You can imagine, because there is such action in everybody's life, in most of the people's lives. Only thing is, it has to be recognized and pursued vehemently with a lot of devotion. So here is an act which I perform with all my enthusiasm, but I do not have any personal advantage to be derived from it. And I know it from... I need not convince people to know it. If you are trying to convince people, then there is a personal advantage in it, that you want to impress the people. That is the personal advantage. So, there is not even that effort to impress people. So, there is absolutely no personal advantage I am trying to derive from it. What an action it is. It is total freedom. That is karma yoga. Therefore, except karma yoga related and bhakti yoga related activities, all other activities which are aimed at pleasures of the world are a waste. They are wasteful actions, and the striver is advised to just relinquish them. Vrutha kriyaha. In fact, all righteous activity is called dharma. Just I will present it in a slightly different model. Dharma is righteous activity. Now, dharma for fulfillment of desires is the topic of dharma shastras, karma kanda. In the Veda there is karma kanda. So, if you want to fulfill this desire, you perform this action. Like Dasaratha Maharaja. He wanted offspring. I want to have offspring. Then Vasishtha told him, okay, you perform this Putrakameshti Yaga. You perform this ritual, you will gain the offspring. Dharmaraja did not seek happiness. Therefore, Vasishtha did not tell him the method of gaining happiness. Rama sought happiness and Vasishtha taught him how to gain happiness. That is Yoga Vasishtha. The treatise on Vairagya and Vedanta, one of the greatest books of Vedanta, Yoga Vasishtha. You must have heard. Dasharatha, there is no Dasharatha Vasishtha. Dasharatha wanted children. Vasishtha told him, do Putra Kameshti Yaga. So he got children. He did not get happiness. He got only children. In fact, he got a load of sorrow, Dasharatha. So much so, after performing Putra Kameshti and gained some children, he died a wretched death. I am not saying anything against Dasharatha, I love him, but he died stricken by grief. Therefore, so kamya karma necessarily leads to happiness and peace of mind. You forget about it, it is never like that. Kamya karma helps you to gain the kamya. Whatever you have desired, you will gain it, that's all. Suppose I want a car. Vahana yoga, they call it. Vahana yoga. Everything is yoga. That is also yoga. Vahana yoga. So, now I go to a numerologist or whatever. He tells me, you do this karma, this puja, etc., you will get vahana. Vahana yoga will come to me. So now I did that puja, and then lo behold, somebody gave me a credit. Earlier I was not having any credit, now I got credit, and I got the car. And I am driving it. I am speeding it. Will I get ticket or not? I will get ticket. No, I have done puja and got this car. Don't give me ticket. He will give ticket. Therefore, kamya karmas are like that. They distort the focus of the mind. So, in the context of karma kanda, the advice given is, relinquish all adharma. Adharma, relinquish it. Keep it away because it will bring papa. You don't want it. You do now, you perform dharma, means righteous actions. Now, what righteous actions should I perform? It depends upon your desires. You tell me what your desires are, I will tell you what are the righteous actions that you have to perform. This is karma kanda, I tell you. This is not Vedanta. Vedanta begins when this ends. This is there in the society. And so, we validate it in its context. In its context, it is okay. Performing adharma is bad, wrong. But performing dharma, the right action or enjoined action for achieving a worldly goal is all okay. In its context, as far as it goes, it is okay. But it doesn't go much far. In fact, it entangles us in samsara. Because our goals are samsaric in nature, then what else do you expect? So that is that level. So I am not talking of that level. Then rise above that level. Now, what is the goal of dharma? Artha and kama. By performing dharma, I gain artha, means resources, so that I can fulfill kama, the pleasures. That is the karma kanda level of looking at dharma. And in a given situation, people may be in that level, which is all right. But here what we are talking of is dharma aimed at artha kama is rejected to vrutha kriyaha tyatva. That kind of dharma also we reject. Then if artha kama are not the goal of dharma, then what is the goal of dharma? Moksha. Dharma is the bridge. You want to go down into the samsara of artha kama through the dharma, you may do it. You are welcome. Or you reject the samsara, turn your back to the samsara, stay with the dharma appropriately and go to moksha. What is it that you want? Here we are talking about moksha. Therefore, that dharma which will take me into the samsara, it has nothing to do with me. I have nothing to do with it. It is left out. Then only that dharma, that righteous action, which is helpful to me in purifying the heart, thereby preparing me for the knowledge of the self, I will undertake. దట్ ఈస్ ది మీనింగ్ ఆఫ్ సేయింగ్ వృథా క్రియా త్యక్త్వా ఆల్ అన్నెసెసరీ యాక్షన్స్ అన్నెసెసరీ ఫ్రమ్ ది పాయింట్ ఆఫ్ వ్యూ ఆఫ్ మోక్ష ప్యూరిఫికేషన్ ఆఫ్ హార్ట్ ఫ్రమ్ దట్ పాయింట్ ఆఫ్ వ్యూ అన్నెసెసరీ యాక్షన్స్ త్యక్త్వా రెనౌన్స్ వీ హ్యావ్ టు రెనౌన్స్ లైక్ దాట్ వీ కెనాట్ ఎంగేజ్ ఇన్ ఆల్ కైండ్స్ ఆఫ్ యాక్టివిటీ అదర్వైజ్ వాట్ హ్యాపెన్స్ యు నో దేర్ విల్ బి ఓన్లీ యాక్టివిటీ లెఫ్ట్ యు సే ఐ గివ్ యూ అన్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్ ఇన్ ఇండియా ఇన్ సికింద్రాబాద్ సపోజ్ దే ఇనాగరేట్ ఎ షాప్ యునో ఇన్ ఇండియా ఆల్ షాప్స్ ఆర్ స్మాల్ 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 షాప్స్ వెరీ సో ఎ పర్సన్ హ్యాజ్ ఎ షాప్ వెరీ స్మాల్ షాప్ హీ క్యాటర్స్ టు సమ్ 30-40 ఫ్యామిలీస్ అండ్ హీ మేక్స్ ఎ స్మాల్ మనీ అవుట్ ఆఫ్ ఇట్ అండ్ హీ లివ్స్ అండ్ సచ్ సపోజ్ యూ పుట్ ఎ వాల్మార్ట్ దెన్ 100 సచ్ షాప్స్ విల్ బి క్లోజ్డ్ సో బట్ ఈవెన్ టుడే ద సిచ్యువేషన్ ఈవెన్ నౌ దిస్ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ సిచ్యువేషన్ ఈస్ కమింగ్ దేర్ బట్ ఈవెన్ నౌ స్మాల్ షాప్స్ విల్ బి దేర్ అండ్ వన్ జెంటిల్మన్ వాంట్స్ టు ఓపెన్ ఎ షాప్ సో హీ రెంట్స్ ఎ స్మాల్ ఏరియా ఇట్ కెన్ బి జస్ట్ డబుల్ ది ప్లాట్ఫామ్ ఇన్ విచ్ ఐఎమ్ సిటింగ్ యూ కెన్ ఇమాజిన్ ఇన్ ఇండియా ఇట్ ఈస్ లైక్ దట్ స్మాల్ ఏరియా అండ్ హీ వాంట్స్ టు ఓపెన్ ఎ షాప్ అండ్ హీ వాంట్స్ ఇట్ టు బి ఇనాగరేటెడ్ బై ఎ స్వామి and so I get so many invitations. They look around, hey, koi swami hai around? So generally I am not very well known in the society. Yeah, I keep a low key purposefully, therefore not known, but some people know. Yeah, above there he sits, go and approach him, then they come to me, Swamiji, you have to inaugurate our shop. They are very nice people, well meaning people. And I need not do anything. I need not carry loads on my head or any such thing. Just they will take in the car, inaugurate the shop, cut the ribbon, and you can bring the scissors with you. They will give it like that if you want. So cut the ribbon, and they will distribute sweets all around, and then you can have some nice tiffin or whatever. Then they offer a bhiksha, and then they give you nice dakshina, and then again leave back at the ashram. So what do you lose out of it? Are you carrying stones or what? This is a very simple thing to do. So, but I refuse. I say, I am not coming. Why? They are surprised. Why, Swamiji? Because from my point of view, you don't need a Swami to inaugurate it. I suggest you pray to Lord Vigneshwara and inaugurate it. And you make good profits. And I will come to your home for bhiksha on one day afterwards. But I am not participating in that inaugural ceremony. In fact, I say it is inappropriate for a Swami to do that. I don't say a dharma, it is inappropriate. Because from a Swami's point of view, it comes under vrutha kriya. For me it is vrutha kriya, not for him. He has to make a living out of it, God bless him. Therefore, just I gave an example how carefully one has to choose his activity. I don't know whether the example is convincing enough, but in the context of a grahastha, so who aims at the knowledge of the self, they have to choose actions very cautiously and very carefully. They should not get entangled in the karma, in the field of karma. Karma is a self-perpetuating, I tell you. You are caught in it, you will not be able to wriggle out of it. It will catch up with you. There is a law, Murphy's law or Patterson's law or some such law is there, Patterson or Peterson. The law is the work in a person's life expands to cover the entire available time, something to that effect, like computers. Earlier, to do accounting of a person, say 100 items accounting you have to do, it will take 2 hours. Now with a click, it will be done. The accounting software is there, you put in that, it is done already. By the time you click it, all accounting is done. You need not do. So how much time you have saved? 1 hour 55 minutes you have saved. Can you, now you are, it is available to you for meditation or what? No. Some other activity grows, the computer related activity alone, it will grow so much that all the 1 hour 55 minutes free time is occupied by this new activity. Therefore, suppose you are walking to your place of work. So it takes 30 minutes. It takes 30 minutes time. Now you go by car. It takes 5 minutes. Now 25 minutes is saved. So can you do meditation extra 25 minutes? No. Some other activity, like weeds, you know, weeds grow to occupy available, entire available space. Like that, the activity grows and it occupies all available time. It is not the matter of time. It is the question of mental energy. The mental energy is sapped by, it is drained by all kinds of activity. And therefore, people should be very choosy in picking up activity, yoga karmasu kaushalam. And having chosen, they should develop a sense of equanimity towards the results of actions. Sukha dukhe samaya kritva labha labhau jaya jayau tato yuddhaya yujyasva samatvam yoga uchyate. I suppose that is the verse. Therefore the equanimity, as the results come in, we have an equanimity towards them. That is yoga. Therefore, So the vrtha kriyaha, choosing the right kind of actions, is very important for a sadhaka. It's a very important point, therefore I spent some time on it. Then vrtha alapan. You see, I will tell you one important point of psychology or the structure of the mind. When we talk, it is not a harmless thing as it appears to be. You see, what happens is, the moment we start talking, we create a verbal universe. Just a verbal universe, we create it. A universe of words, ideas and concepts. So, these words, ideas, concepts, they are interwoven, like web. And they are interdependent. So now, if you talk for, say, 2-3 people together, talk, say, for 10 minutes or 15 minutes, now they are in that web of a world, a verbal world, a verbal universe, spun by words. You please pay attention to this. You think about it. The very real it is. It is happening every day in our life. Suppose 2-3 people come together and start talking about some of the issues that start talking about. Start gossiping. Start discussing about some of the issues of the institute or whatever. Really speaking, there are no issues. Even if a small issue is there, it could be readily resolved without any such gossip and discussion. But the gossip and discussion doesn't contribute anything to anybody's advantage. Just it creates an imaginary world, a verbal world, which has no corresponding reality. And so we are caught in the ideas, the words, and the thoughts related to that purely fictional verbal universe. And we then slowly what happens, the more you talk about these things, the more they appear to be real. In fact, they are not real. They just appear to be real as you talk more and more about them. Suppose there is a party. The contents of the party, the discussions that take place in the party, they do not correspond to any reality of life. They are totally useless discussions. Party, if not a party, something else. Therefore, it is difficult to explain more than that. So, this verbal world is created. There is no reality to it. And that verbal world is utterly without any essence or substance. The verbal universe is purely a creation of the mind. And therefore, the words, the use of words continuously, the speech, it has a capacity to create a mythical world of ideas and concepts. You use certain words. These words invoke a few more words from the other person. Or in your own mind, as you start using words, words create more words. And so it just spins like that. And we are caught in a very unreal world of, or universe of, virbios, and it binds. Anyway, Therefore, we are advised to talk purposefully, and any time I open my mouth, it should be purposeful, and it should be inspired by love and kindness. It could be in a given situation a bit stern. I talk sternly, fairly and frankly. If I have to give a warning to somebody, say subordinate in the office, etc., I use minimum words. This is even a management principle. A manager who talks and talks and talks about the discipline, about the commitment to work, etc., with the subordinates, who goes on giving lectures, he will be ignored by the subordinates. Whereas a manager who talks minimum but to the point, and he means what he says, and he stands by what he says, he performs his work according to what he said, and he expects others to perform according to the instructions what he has given. He is a man of few words, but he means what he says. Such a manager is highly respected, and he becomes successful. Go on talking and talking and talking. It is meaningless. It is very important. Even for management it is important. For Vedanta it is all the more important. That's why the students of Vedanta, in the class, they you need not perform. In the class you are a spectator, like watching the tennis match. You don't perform anything. You are a spectator, so be a spectator. Swamiji comes and I am not talking about this class. I am talking about a possible class, an imaginary class where this could be like that. Swamiji comes and tells something, something he is teaching. So he will teach. Yesterday he has done up to this verse. Today he will do two more verses. And we sit and watch. Sometimes they finish breakfast and so come with a full belly to the class. And so the sompar, etc., will be there. You know, somp. After breakfast, it is kept there and they put some of it in the mouth. And so they are sitting in the class. Spectators. Total 100% spectator. No participation. Talking of vairagya. Okay, vairagya. Spectator. You are a spectator, not participating. No performance. Spectator. I tell you, like the, and in between classes, the performance, spectatorship only, one class is over, and another class, grab a cup of tea, all sensate values, you know, bhogas. Bhogas are not to be avoided. So grab a cup of tea, and maybe one or two snacks also to go with it, and then again some somp, and again class. Spectatorship. Then have a nice lunch, a nap. This is the study of Vedanta. Kya Vedanta? Is there any Vedanta in it? Vedanta is not it is not studying a few books. You should not be brought to that level. It is not like studying physics or chemistry. You just gather some information and hold it in your intellect. That is not Vedanta. You live even an iota of what you have come to know. An iota of the precept, you live it. That is Vedanta. A living thought is worth more than 1,000 libraries. A living thought, one thought you live, it is worth more than 1,000 libraries. That is what it is. And so, vritha alapan, this verbios, so speaking unnecessarily, without any purpose, wasting the mental energies through speech, has to be avoided. If you remember, in Mundaka it says, Atmanam evaikam janatha anya vacho vimunchatha. You have to know only one thing in this life, that is Atma, which includes everything. By the time you know one thing, that one thing is not separate from everything else. It includes everything else. Atmanameva ekam janatha anya vacho vimunchatha. You keep all other speech away. Don't speak unnecessarily. Go on speaking wasteful things without any purpose. creating more and more ragadveshas, it is all waste. So anyavacho vimunchatha. So like this, we engage in all kinds of discussions with which we have no relevance. And the real thing we ignore in the process. So it should not be done. Vrutha vadan. Vada means disputation. I tell you, there is a notion among people that philosophy is about all kinds of disputations. Advaitins, Dvaitins, Visishta Advaitins, then Bodhas, Sankhyas, Tarkikas, they all will be disputing among themselves. That is what philosophy is. All wrong. It's not like that. The disputations are not encouraged. It is not a study of various disputations among the scholars. That is not what Vedanta is. So, there may be Purvapaksha Siddhanta kind of it's a method of teaching. It's a beautiful method of teaching. A binary method. A question is raised and then an answer is given. Sometimes the questioner plays devil's advocate. Purposefully he plays the devil's advocate. The questioner also is put in place by Shankara only. Shankara only writes Purvapaksha and Siddhanta. Purvapaksha is the questioner. And sometimes the questioner raises a sincere doubt and sometimes he plays the devil's advocate. He wants to put the Siddhanti down. And so like that, because the mind is capable of all kinds of doubts. So all those doubts are conceived, they are anticipated by Shankara, and they are put in the mouth of a mythical Purvapakshi, an imaginary Purvapakshi. Sometimes if the doubts are very powerful, then the Purvapakshi assumes the role of a devil's advocate, and they are put as questions and doubts, and then answers are given. The binary method. That is the method of teaching. It is not a study of disputations among various scholars. Therefore, this notion that our Mahatma has won against that Mahatma. My Guru is superior to that Guru. My Guru's teachings are more shining than that Guru's teachings. This is all silly. So we should raise above these things. So there is only one Atma, and what you consider as other, there is no other. It looks like other, but it is all Atma only. Anyway, so vrutha vadam, meaningless disputations. Now, whether it was right what happened in Iraq, is it right or not? Okay, you may tell your opinion, nothing wrong. You may have your opinion, but engaging in discussions, disputations, start sending 2005 emails, 2500 emails, and then create public opinion. What is all this? It is a worldly thing. It is not Vedanta. In Vedanta, you do not go and attack the world. You do not go and submerge yourself in the world. You don't do either this or that. You just, mostly you ignore the world. World is like that. Like the tail of a dog, it was crooked in the entire history of mankind. World is like that. You are not going to rectify the world now. World is like that. You see, I give you an example. A small joke, if you can call it. So, an archaeologist was digging a site, and so plates on which things were written in the ancient scripture, in the script, or even hieroglyphics or something, symbols are used as language. So that kind of a plate emerged, and now he was poring over that plate. What is written on that plate? Its date is already fixed. It is 2500 years old. That is the date of that plate. And he was poring over it. And he was deciphering the code. He has now deciphered after a lot of research. And now the message emerges. The message is one minister telling the king, "O king, the society is all wrong. Nobody is following dharma. There is so much conflict. and there is so much ashanti, there is no dharma at all in the society, all people are misbehaving. That is what is written in that plate. Now, that is over, joke is over, don't expect any something more about it. Over, joke is over. So, the society is like the tail of a dog, it is like that. So, one person, he had a dog, a pet dog. So now he took a stick and tied this stick to the tail with a string. And so the dog is moving around. Somebody asked, why do you do that? Because I want to make this tail perfect, straight. So how long will you keep it? For 3 days or 4 days I will keep it, then it will become normal. Okay. After 3 days he removed that stick and it became like again crooked. Therefore, don't engage in disputations about the state of the society, state of the world, dharma, adharma, all these disputations are meaningless. Is there something for you to do about it? Do it. Wholeheartedly do it as an offering to the Lord. And then be quiet. Ratha vadam, manorathan, relinquish all wasteful desires. Don't desire a thing which is very normal. It is like desiring midnight, you wake up and then desire. I wish it becomes morning quickly. Why, what kind of desire it is? You should not have that kind of a desire. It will become morning in its time. So, most of our desires are like that. So, one pregnant woman told me, Swamiji, I feel that the giving birth will happen very, very soon. I told Amma, you should not have any such desires. Just stay where you are. Because the moment you project a desire, even a silly desire, agitates the mind. It brings in a worry. Because a desire means, at that moment, there is fear in that desire. Otherwise, it cannot be desire. A desire means there is fear. The fear is, oh, whether it will be fulfilled or not. That kind of a fear. You may not be able to articulate it all the time, but it is there. I desire that. Okay, there is already a heartbeat is skipped. Will it happen or not? Like that. The system is strained temporarily. If the desire is small, if the desire is big, then it remains in stress only. Therefore, don't desire anything. I may live long. Why should you desire like that? You will live long. Already we are living longer than necessary and we will live long further. No need to desire it. So, I should be healthy. Don't desire. You work for it. Do exercise and stop all desiring about it and work hard. You will be healthy. Just by desiring that I should be healthy and go on eating unnecessary things won't make anybody healthy. Therefore, no need to project any desire. The kids should have a bright future. Immediately there will be fear whether they will have a bright future or not. So, don't project any such things. They will have a bright future. They will have to face the opposites in life. The way we faced the opposites in life. Therefore, all what I am trying to say, even some of the innocuous looking desires are meaningless desires. Very simple, what is wrong? I am not talking about right, wrong. Meaningful or meaningless. So just keep the mind empty of all desires. Desirelessness is not a stale state of mind, please understand. It is fullness. It is not a stale state. Don't be misled by the word desirelessness. It is not a stale state of mind, it is a fullness. So, relinquish all meaningless desires. Chaktva, then what should I do? You need not do anything. You should only know. Ekam Brahma Vijnayam. There is only one reality, which is the Atma, which is the Brahma, one without the second. And knowing that one's own true nature should be the goal of life. Iti Vedanta Dindimaha. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate. పూర్ణస్య పూర్ణమాదాయ పూర్ణమేవాశిష్యే ఓం శాంతి 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 హరి ఓం శ్రీ గురుభ్యో నమః. హరి ఓం దత్సత్ శ్రీకృష్ణార్పణమస్తు.